Hey all, the goal of this segment is to give you an introduction to bulk light transport. So up until now we have been discussing light scattering at very basic levels, dipole scattering as the most fundamental scattering process. We've looked at scattering by particles such as red blood cells. But the question now arises, can we also describe scattering, or maybe better, light propagation for bulk tissues, so for larger tissue volumes? There are a couple of ways to do that, and in order to introduce them, these are the topics of today. So first we'll discuss some radiometric quantities. After that, the first approach to bulk light propagation, the radiative transport equation. Then a brief intermezzo to introduce the reduced scattering coefficients, mu s prime. Then the second method to describe bulk tissue light propagation, diffusion approximation to the radiative transport equation, or diffusion theory for short. And finally, Monte Carlo simulations. If you want to read up on this topics, then I suggest you read chapter 1, 2, and 3 of the book for an overview, and perhaps chapter 16 and 17 for some application examples. So let's take a look first at the quantities we can use to describe the transport of photon energy. The first is intensity, or irradiance, which is defined as the photon energy per unit area per unit time. We can combine, of course, photon energy and time to redefine intensity as the photon power per unit area in units of watts per square meter. We can use it, for example, to quantify tissue elimination, as you can see in this illustration. And it's important to note that this quantity depends on geometry only, not on the optical properties. So it is a property of the illumination. The second quantity is the radiance, which is defined as the optical power flowing through a unit area in a unit solid angle into a direction here given by factor s. So it is a directional quantity. It's defined at a certain location and it is evaluated in a certain direction. Therefore, the units of radiance are watts per square meter per star radian. A closely related quantity is the fluence rate, which is then at the location r is the optical power flowing from or to a unit area in any direction. And clearly, the fluence rate is related to the radiance by this integral equation. So if you integrate the radiance over all solid angles, then the result is the fluence rate. The fluence rate is an important property. For example, the local fluence rate times the local absorption cross-section gives us the local absorbed power, which can then be used, for example, for heat generation, for treatment, or diagnostic signals. Likewise, the local fluence rate times the local absorption coefficient is the local absorbed power density, as you can easily see if you evaluate the units of these expressions. Finally, we can use photon fluxes to describe the transport of photon energy. We have directional fluxes, F plus and minus. F plus, the photon flux in the positive direction, is the radiance integrated over half solid angle in the forward direction, in the plus direction, and the directional flux in the negative direction is then the same, the radiance integrated over half solid angle, but then in the opposite direction. With these two definitions, we can define a net flux as the difference between the positive and the negative directional flux, and we can define a total flux as the sum of the two. For example, if we take a look at the previous cartoon where we had an intensity illuminating the surface of a piece of tissue, in that case the flux in the positive direction, so along the positive z-axis, equals the intensity, and also if light escapes the tissue in the other direction, then the flux in the negative direction would equal the reflectance from this tissue. So armed with this knowledge, we can now take a look at the radiative transport equation, which is basically an energy or power balance for a volume element inside the tissue. It's important to note that this is an incoherent description, so electric fields, or maybe better, the phases of the electric fields, are not considered here. And any coherent effects that maybe should be taken into account, such as dependent scattering, they are supposed to be accounted for in the optical properties themselves, so in the scattering coefficient or in the phase function. The approach is then to set up a power balance for a small volume dV in the tissue around a unit solid angle in a certain direction S. And for the optical power flowing through that volume, we can have loss terms. There can be divergence of the of the radiance from DV. There can be absorption inside the volume DV, and there can be losses due to scattering from that volume. On the other hand, there are also possible gain terms. There could be a light source in the volume V, for example, a fluorescent molecule. And there could be scattering into DV from any other direction, S prime, into the direction of evaluation S. So we'll set up this power balance, and the general differential form of terms will be as follows. So a change in power in the volume is going to be expressed proportional to the radiance in that volume at R in the direction S at a given time, and then times the differential unit solid angle and differential area. So to do so, we'll consider that our volume element is a cylindrical volume element, so it has an area dA and a thickness dS. We'll evaluate the energy or the power change within the omega, the unit solid angle, into the direction of S during the time interval dt. The volume element is supposed to be stationary and located at position R. And the optical properties, so the refractive index, the absorption coefficient, scattering coefficient, phase function, etc., are all considered time independent, but they can be location dependent, of course. So the first loss term is energy divergence per unit time from the volume element, and is given by the equation here. So the loss in of the differential change in power is proportional to the gradient of the radiance with respect to the direction S. Also note that there is a inner product in there of the unit vector n, which is perpendicular to the area element dA and with the direction S. That's because we observe the radiance under a given angle. We can rewrite this equation slightly using the divergence operator nabla and also using the distributive property of the inner product to arrive at this final expression in blue. Then the second loss term, of course, is due to attenuation or extinction, which is the sum of the scattering and absorption losses. So we can define now the attenuation coefficient, mu t, as the sum of the absorption and the scattering coefficients. We, of course, note that the probability of extinction when the light travels a very short unit length ds is equal to mu t times ds. So that's a probability. If you look at the units, it works out. So we can combine these two as an expression for extinction losses, which is, of course, scales with the probability of extinction. It scales with the local radiance, and then it's evaluated again over the unit solid angle and the unit area. So the final expression is then found by, this expression. Then there's gain terms. The most complicated is that there can be energy scattered into the volume from any direction S-accent. And of course, the change of light, of the direction of light, is governed by the phase function. So this term, this gain term, is given by, again, a probability of scattering. So mu s times ds is the probability of scattering. And then the integral term adds together all the radiance all the radiance contributions coming from direction S prime scattered into the direction S by proper weighting by the phase function. The phase function now here is written as a function of S prime and S of the directions. Of course, if we express this in spherical coordinates, it would be our conventional way of writing as a the phase function as a function of polar and azimuthal scattering angle. Again, we can work this equation into the standard form in blue. And now we assume that there is no dependence on phi in the phase function, and also that the only dependence on the polar angle theta comes in the form of a cosine. So the S prime S dependence is here replaced by an inner product of unit vectors S prime and S, which is then cosine theta. Finally, the gain term. There is also a gain term possible when there is a light source inside the volume. And again, this could be, for example, a fluorescent molecule. So that term is easily added like this. So then the conservation of energy tells us that whatever is produced in or scattered into the volume, the gain terms, added to losses by extinction or by divergence, that has to equal the change of photon energy in the volume within that unit solid angle per time. So that term can be written as follows. So the change per unit time is the differential of the radiance with respect to time. So then the differential form of this energy balance, the differential form of the transport equation, becomes as given here. So the change of power in time is equal to the loss terms, the divergence and extinction, and the gain terms, scattering and possible source and possible source contributions. Well, we can integrate this equation to go from a differential form to an integral form, and the result is the radiative transport equation, or the Boltzmann equation. And in this process, the dVs and the omegas drop out. So what we are left with is this spatiotemporal differential equation for the radiance. Now, for a stationary response, so when there is no time dependence, so there is continuous illumination and etc., then the left-hand side will be zero. There will be no change in time. But even then, it is difficult to solve, because there are then six independent variables remaining, or if time is there, there are seven independent variables. We have x, y, and z for the coordinates of r, and we have sx, sy, and sz as directional cosines of the vector s for the directions. So this can only be solved in the simplest geometries. One approach to do this, however, is to assume an homogeneous infinite medium, so no boundaries are present, in which case we can invoke some kind of spherical symmetry. Then we can express the radiance as a series expansion of spherical harmonics, and we can express the phase function as a series of Legendre polynomials in argument cosine theta. If we express the phase function as Legendre polynomials, the expression is given here. So p of x is then the phase function, is this summation of Legendre polynomials, which are appropriately weighted by the factors gn, which are called the Legendre moments, which in turn can be calculated if we know the phase function and we know the description of the nth order Legendre polynomials. And again, this is now written as function of argument x is cosine theta if we switch to our conventional but slightly more complicated description than the equation here remains. A few of these terms we have already encountered. If n is zero, then the zeroth order Legendre polynomial is equal to unity. So if we plug that into the expression, then g0, the zeroth order Legendre moment, is going to be one unity, because what remains is just the expression, the normalization expression of the phase function. N is 1, we also encountered. In that case, the Legendre polynomial s equals x, or cosine theta. So plugging that into the definition will actually give the expression for the scattering anisotropy, the average cosine of the scattering angle. So g1, the first order Legendre polynomial, is equal to the parameter that we have called the scattering anisotropy before. We can, of course, repeat this procedure up until any arbitrary value n. And the interesting result is that an n-term expansion yields n so-called similarity relations. These relations hold, for example, for fluence rate or for reflectance or any property that can be derived from this equation. What does this imply? As an example, a tissue with a set of scattering properties, so let's say mu s, as the scattering coefficient, and then a set of Legendre polynomials, Legendre moments describing the phase function g1 until gn, will yield the same reflectance as a tissue with mu s star, g1 star, g2 star, up until gn star, if these relations are satisfied. So if the product of mu s times 1 minus g1 equals the product of mu s star times 1 minus g1 star, etc., then these will yield the same reflections. A special notation is available for the first similarity relation, because we found just before that g1 was equal to the scattering anisotropy, so we usually drop this subscript, so the similarity relation just becomes mu s times 1 minus g equals mu s star times 1 minus g star, and for this compound product we have a new symbol, mu s prime, which is the reduced scattering coefficient. Now back to the radiative transport equation. Let's assume that we have made this expression, this expansion in spherical harmonics for the radiance, and we have made this expansion for the phase function and Legendre polynomials. We can truncate this expansion at the first order. And in that case, we are left, of course, with something that that results in certain limits of validity because we throw away some information. And we find that the remaining similarity relation is for this mu s prime parameter. The result of this is a simplification of the radiative transport equation that that results in a diffusive, kind of a diffusive description of photon energy. So, for example, we obtain a fixed first law of diffusion, but then for photon energy, which here relates the net flux with the fluence rate. So the net flux on the left-hand side is expressed as the spatial derivative of the fluence rate, and the proportionality constant is then the photon diffusion coefficient d. And for completeness, a possible source term is added to this equation as well. Also, we can get a diffusion equation for fluence rate here. So the the derivative of the divergence of the fluence rate equals either zero or possibly a source term that's present there. So this features the photon diffusion coefficient, and that one is related to the reduced scattering coefficient by this equation. So 1/3 the reduced scattering coefficient. So the result of this this exercise is that we have now reduced the complicated radiative transport equation into a simpler set of equations that can be used further, and that the individual optical property of the individual optical properties scattering coefficient and phase function do not enter into this formulas anymore. The only thing that that remains is the compounded parameter mu s prime, so mu s times 1 minus g. Of course, there are some limitations, as mentioned. One of the most important consequences is that that the diffusion approximation to the RTE is not really valid very near boundaries. It's also not really valid when, for example, the separation between the source and detector is very small. So that is something that always needs to be taken into account when using the diffusion approximation. However, it does yield useful results. So let's take an example. The general derivation assumed that that the media were infinite. Of course, if a better model for tissue would be to consider it as a homogeneous semi-infinite medium. So it has a boundary from which light can enter the tissue and also from which light can escape the tissue to be detected. So the situation is then given here. Let's assume this semi-infinite tissue. We have a pencil beam, so a very narrow stream of photons, a very narrow laser beam pointing along the positive z-axis, and we can calculate now the reflected intensity, the reflectance, as a function of the radial coordinate along the surface. I'm going to give you the result immediately. And this expression at first sight may look a little bit complicated and a little bit convoluted. Well, it certainly is convoluted. We have some distances in here, R1 and R2, which are a function of the depth coordinate z and of the radial coordinate rho, but also, like in the primary equation, term z0, z sub 0 appears, and the diffusion coefficient appears. In deriving this equation, this pencil beam along the z-axis is actually replaced by two point sources, one located at depth z0 equal to mu s prime inside the medium, and one mirror image located, a virtual source located on the other side of the boundary, so in the void at a position z0 plus 4d above the tissue boundary. And then again, we have the scattering, we have the diffusion coefficient d, which was 1/3 mu s prime, and we have an effective attenuation coefficient, which has both the effects of absorption and scattering in there, equal to the square root of 3 times mu a, the absorption coefficient, times the reduced scattering coefficient. But of course, there are many situations where even this this simplified diffusion theory will not work. For example, if we are close to sources, or boundaries, or when the geometry just gets too complicated to be accurately captured into boundary conditions. So our last resort then is to do Monte Carlo simulations, where we trace a random walk of individual photons through the tissue until they are detected. The idea is then to repeat this process many, many times, millions of times, and that ultimately the statistics of the detected photons will then tell us something about how the light propagated through the tissue. Just to give you two examples, these are two situations, A and B, where in A, two fibers are used. One fiber is used to launch light into the tissue. The other is used to detect light from the tissue. And in panel B, the same thick fiber is used to launch and to collect photons. The colorful random lines here are individual simulated photon trajectories. So the photons actually do make some kind of random walk in the tissue. The little dots correspond to the location where scattering events occurred. And as you can see, on average, for these simulations, the photons only scatter over very small scattering angles, and sometimes they scatter over larger scattering angles. So that would correspond to a more or less forward-directed phase function. So how does this work? We use uniform random numbers generated by the computer to calculate random properties of the photon walk. So we launch a photon, and using a couple of random numbers, that means that we choose a random launch location, for example, on the face of that fiber surface. Then again, we use new, fresh random numbers to calculate step sizes, calculate scattering angles over which the photon will be redirected. We can use random numbers to decide whether or not the photon is absorbed. And if it's not absorbed, we will update the position of the photon. And we keep doing that until the photon is terminated or detected or any other rule is satisfied. Then we store the data and we start a new photon, etc., 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 until we have built up enough statistics to do that. So essentially, we split the photon trajectory into a chain of propagation, scattering, etc. events at each step, generating a fresh set of numbers and translating that into what we need to decide at that moment. So to illustrate, we can draw a random number in the computer from 0 to 1 and calculate from that a random step size for the photon. That will depend, of course, on the attenuation coefficient, so the probability of scattering and the probability of absorption per unit length. And if we do the calculations, as we will see later, then a random value for the step size can be calculated from this uniform random number as minus 1 over the attenuation coefficient times the natural logarithm of that random number. For the scattering angles, more or less the same, we have the phase function as a probability density function for scattering angle. So for example, if we use the Rayleigh phase function, then we can calculate a random value for the polar scattering angle theta as 2 times the random number minus 1. And then for the azimuthal angle, we draw a fresh random number, and we can calculate that as 2 pi times the value of that random number. And of course, there is a lot of other things that can be processed the same way. For example, when the photon crosses a boundary, we can calculate what percentage of that photon or of these photons are reflected using Fresnel's equations. We can choose launch positions on the fiber. We can have that depend on the numerical aperture of the fiber or the detection system, etc., etc. So essentially, this method is really versatile, and we can simulate light propagation in very complicated geometries. So in conclusions, we have a few methods for describing light propagation in bulk tissue. The first is the one we discussed is the radiative transport equation. It's exact, but it's which is an advantage. But it's very difficult to solve. Only in the simplest conditions can we find useful answers. Then we can approximate. We can make approximations to the RTE. The diffusion approximation is the most widely used. It gives simpler solutions, for example, for reflectance and fluence rate. And these have the main advantage that they are invertible. That means that if we do a measurement, we can invert these models and extract from the measurement of reflectance, for instance, we can extract the optical properties. Of course, the drawbacks are that they have a limited range of validity, so sometimes the theory does not match the experimental situation, for example, at short source detector separations. And finally, we have Monte Carlo simulations, which where the main advantage is that they are extremely versatile. If we can model our geometry, then we can calculate almost everything. The downside is, of course, that they can be very time-consuming if we have to simulate a lot of photons to build up statistics. And that also means that sometimes they are difficult to invert. If we have a very stationary measurement geometry, where it's invertible through lookup tables, for example, but if something in the measurement system is a little bit dynamic, that would, in principle, require redoing Monte Carlo simulations time and time and again. So again, this video is ultimately about kicking the can down the road a little bit again. We'll have separate lectures on the radiative transport equation, on the diffusion theory, and also on Monte Carlo, where we go into detail, much more detail of these descriptions.